Hello and welcome back to Breaking Ground on iProperty Radio with myself, Carol Tallon. You can contact us on social media at iProperty Radio or email hello at iPropertyRadio.com. This week, I'm joined by Cian O'Mahony. He's the head of operations and head of development at Siro. So, Cian, you're very welcome. Thank you for joining us today. Siro, people will be familiar with the brand, but you might just kind of break down what it is that you do in the context of construction delivery.
Yep. Good morning, Carol. Thank you very much for having me. So Siro is a joint venture between ESB and Vodafone. We were put together in about 2015 and really launched commercially in 2016. We build 100% fiber using the ESB distribution network. And so for many of your listeners, that will be a familiar concept to them, but then hopefully to those that aren't, that's a key point to, for them to take away today, that our fiber reaches the premise using the existing ESB infrastructure. So when you're talking to developers putting in infrastructure into new housing estates, it's one less thing for them to think about. It's not an additional underground network that they need to deploy. We use what's already there. And we were set up to really roll out fiber broadband across the country, not specifically to new developments or anything of that nature. But it just so happens that if your listeners are engaged in the construction industry and are putting together new housing estates, our unique proposition to them is that we use the existing infrastructure. And as ESB, as a shareholder, we work to the same standards really as ESB. So it's an extremely high grade, future-proofed fiber infrastructure that we feel helps customers, and we feel it's a very compelling element to the houses and to the house selling process at the moment. And we can talk through some of the research that has been done by ourselves and by some of the key developers in the industry as the interview goes on. I think that that really highlights that. But that's who Siro are, joint venture between ESB and Vodafone. Started in 2015. We have enabled fiber into almost 500,000 premises, so nearly 500,000 premises. And we're still going strong. We have a commitment up to 770,000. So we are still rolling out our network very much. So we're not standing still at all. There's still a huge demand for the product, and so we're excitedly bringing the network to new towns around the country all the time.
Very good, very good. And so, in addition to being the head of operations, obviously you've responsibility for the new developments. So obviously, connectivity is always an issue that on new developments and new estates. And obviously Irish Water is the one that's most prominently in the news all the time. ESB has certainly attracted their criticism, but in terms of infrastructure, telecoms infrastructure, that tends to be slightly further along the line. So actually, because you're working off the ESB network, do developers have to wait until the ESB network kind of is in place before they contact you, or can both of those things be done at the same time?
No, that's a great question, Carol. The earlier we're engaged in that process, the better. We want to ensure that the M&Es who are setting out the tender documents to the ultimate contractors that are going to deploy the materials on site are familiar with the considerations for the Siro network. So we do use the existing ESB ducts, and we do use the existing ESB BC2s. But where it comes to airtight houses, we have a couple of options for how we get from the mini pillars into each of the homes. And it makes no difference to Siro really as to how we get from the mini pillar into the premise. But I think from a developer perspective, the earlier we're part of that discussion, we can lay out those options. Whereas if we kind of come in after a certain stage of construction has been completed, really those options are restricted. And in our experience, those developers are for varying reasons, because as you know, that the house shape or the shape of the houses that are being built, whether they're duplexes, townhouses, 1/2, part MDU blocks, they're so unique and different that it's never a one size fits all. And so the earlier we're part of that conversation, the more we can find a solution to getting the fiber into each individual premise, which is just that last little bit, but it means a less mess installation, which is what every developer wants. They want to ensure that the people moving into those premises can get broadband seamlessly and as seamlessly as possible. And that's very much the way the industry is moving. So early engagement is key. The siro.ie/new developments website has plenty of contact us forms, and We can be found through LinkedIn or anything like that, so or social media platforms as well.
Excellent. I think it's really interesting how, you know, on the show here every week we talk about changes across the construction industry. Some are happening faster than others, you know, some are frustratingly slow. But I think it's really the M&E sector is a particularly interesting one because that has transformed. So the M&E design has transformed over the past two decades, not just in terms of smart technologies and HVAC systems that are directly contributing to the building performance. But now when you're looking at connectivity, you know, so actually the work of an M&E designer has really changed probably more than any of the other areas of construction over the last 20 years. So how are you seeing that reflected now in the developers? Do you think that, just given your perspective, working with developers up and down the country, you know, are the design teams savvy as to what needs to happen now and in what order?
Yeah, I think so. I think so, Carl. I think they really do get it. So we commissioned some research last year to really independently understand that. We're so close to it. We feel we know it. And sometimes it's important to step back and to test and to gauge just how correct you are. And so the research we conducted last year spoke to just over 1,500 people across the different parts of the country, both first-time buyers and second-time buyers, different demographics and so forth. The biggest thing that under 35s wanted in their house was broadband. They wanted that over a garden, over parking, over ensuite. The number one thing under 35 said was broadband. And then even so across the age brackets, over 55s, 28% of them said it was the most important. So it wasn't like it fell off a cliff as you go through the decades. Actually, because one of the comments, I was listening back to some of your podcasts recently, and you interviewed Liz O'Kane, fantastic speaker. And when you asked her about the profile of first-time buyers in Ireland, and she said it's 25 to 55, and she said, I'm not joking.
Yeah,
and I think I would definitely echo that. I think what we think is most important, and what the designers, what the M&Es think is most important, is different for different customer sections. It's a much broader pool, and the fact that, you know, almost like certainly over a quarter of over 55s that are in the buying process, first time buyers and second time buyers, are still saying that broadband is as compelling. It's not just an entertainment element. They really understand the work component of it. And a major developer recently released a piece of research which said something similar, that the remote working hubs was seen as a key factor in their buying decision process, I think. And they said that 60% of people indicated that as a first-time buyer more than a second-time buyer. But it just shows just how important it's become. And I think the M&Es very much do. They think about the end users. That's, in a way, that's kind of what they have to do, how they lay it out. And they do it very well. They ask those questions. They're very driven to understand the minutiae of how we deploy our systems. And we get very good engagement from them. But it really comes back from the developer. They need to endorse it in the first instance.
I think the research, though, that you talk about is very interesting. You know, when you say that actually this goes beyond entertainment, because I would imagine if you had done that survey 5 years ago, it would have been more with entertainment and lifestyle in mind. However, since COVID, obviously people are particularly going into new builds. If they're going into new builds outside of Dublin, a lot of them are doing it on the basis of remote working for a certain number of days per week. So actually it's well beyond entertainment. It's actually survival. It's the ability to be able to do it. So this morning, I am not in our Dundrum studio. I'm not even in our City West office. And I'm in fact over in the Galway office, which I would not be able to do. I don't think I would have been able to do that 10 years ago, but we can do it today. And in fact, I think how we prioritize our life, it does surprise me to hear that people under 35 put Wi-Fi ahead of things like gardens, probably not parking, but certainly things like gardens. But I do understand it. That's probably where they've been in the last 2 years of their life, stuck in a small house or apartment, but needing Wi-Fi for work. It's interesting. The industry always has to move with consumers. And, you know, I would always argue that the industry should be leading consumers. It shouldn't be waiting to be led by it. But look, it doesn't surprise me at all that this is as basic as electricity for people moving into their new homes. But tell me, what kind of developers and developments are you working with?
I think we have network in something like 84 plus towns around the country at the moment. So there's very few household developers that we're not engaged with. But I'm very conscious that the industry is built up of so many developers that are much, much smaller than the household names. And really, that's the audience we hope to reach out to today. That's a fantastic thing about the Irish economy is that it's built on individuals that might only build 10 to 20 houses. There are so many of those, and they're the backbone of the construction industry. And reaching out to them is harder because they have less time to engage. And so we're still very keen to speak to all construction and development businesses, large and small. But in terms of the projects, look, we're involved in the biggest and the smallest.
Would you consider the smallest? Like, would you be dealing with what is it, only developments, or would you deal with self builds?
No, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, if our network is there, because our network is, I think we have in excess of 10,000 kilometers of feeder distribution network deployed across the country. We're on a lot of roads. And so therefore houses are popping up along those roads. And I think there was a stat 2 years ago that 25% of all new houses were one-off constructions. So of course, absolutely, Carl, we would pick those up where they are reachable from our network, and where they are not directly within our design standards, say that they're a little bit too much of a distance. Again, those individuals can reach out to us, and if we can find some solution to kind of bridge that gap, then we'll do so to bring our network to those customers.
Sorry, just to clarify though, if you're working off the ESB network and ESB is going into the home, how would yours stop before that?
Well, ESB wouldn't bring us in just by matter of course. So we could be part of a line diversion, which absolutely, if our fiber is touching that asset that's being moved, I'm really talking if we're kind of maybe, you know, 500 meters back and we wouldn't necessarily be part of ESB works. And then we would look into that. So, but absolutely, if we're part of the ESB infrastructure that passes that property, then ESB work with us to make sure that our network is moved. If any customers are affected, then that's a whole process that we have in place. And that covers that all for sure.
Yeah, no, because that's actually one of the points of frustration around self-builds, actually, because generally they will look for an ESB connection at a very early stage. But telecoms can take a little bit longer than that, and particularly fibre. And, you know, again, it depends on where you are in the country, that's still an impact, you know, and I think that maybe there's a perception that the further away from the larger cities you get, that's worse. But actually, in my experience, that's not true at all. Having lived 15 minutes from Dublin in Blessington, we had woeful internet and phone signal and everything. And in fact, when I came over to the wilds of Connemara, I was blown away by how great both mobile and internet was. So it's definitely the perception that somehow the further you are from the cities is just completely inaccurate. But we still need to be able to guarantee this to every home in the country.
Yeah, and I think that the point you're making there about the timing is really key. And it's something that we are very mindful of, that in order for the customer's move-in experience, whether they're a one-off home or whether they're a part of a small development or a major one, it's no different. Having broadband at as early a stage in that process as possible is key. And I moved during COVID. My family and I lived in Dublin, worked there. And then during COVID, we reassessed. My wife is from Clare, and our kids are of an age where growing up with their cousins was a very compelling proposition. And we decided to relocate to Ennis in County Clare. And so very similar. We took the opportunity that COVID afforded us. And when I was going through that buying decision, the available broadband of the property was key. I ruled out properties because they were not, they wouldn't have fit the purpose that myself and my family would have required. And it's nothing to do with what the kids watch. It's to do with myself and my wife being able to work remotely for businesses that are based out of Dublin. Yeah. And we still travel, we still do the day or two. That's really important. It's not 100%, but I think being hybrid and being up there to a degree is really a good balance to have. But being able to work without any concerns with your broadband connection when you're home is imperative now to us. And so I would empathize with those people. And the timeliness is no good moving into a brand new home and having to wait 6 months for your broadband. That's not when your employment depends upon it. It's too important. And so again, a key message to the developers that are listening to this program today is that early engagement is critical, because if we are aware of the ESB works, because under GDPR, if ESB are asked to do something, they can't pass that information on to Siro as a separate entity. Yeah. They have to engage with us differently. Now, if the asset is moved, it's one and the same. But if the asset is near but not moved, then we're completely blind to it. Now, we will monitor the networks. We review all the planning applications around the country. We do what we can to pick it up. But there's always more. And so a little bit of proactivity on the developer side will go a long way with us. So.
I'm always interested in the consumer take, because we do a lot of business to business. So we talk to the industry, we talk about the industry, and sometimes it can be hard to capture those consumer insights that are really dictating many of our trends. You know, so I'm interested to hear the perceptions of under 25s and those over 55 and, you know, everybody in between. But I know that your company has done quite a bit of market research on other things like, you know, the connectivity of smart devices in the home. That's something that, excuse me, I think, you know, hasn't been properly, I don't know, is it just poor PR on the part of Ireland? But only in the last few days, I had lunch with an American woman who herself and her husband recently relocated, in the last couple of years, relocated to Ireland, and they're redoing an old house. And they said, you know, in the US, they had smart technology. They were able to, you know, turn on their hot water before they got home, or turn on heating before they got to their home. And I'm like, yes, of course we have all that in Ireland. And she didn't know that that was available in Ireland. And obviously it's been available in Ireland for many years. So, you know, do you think, is there a huge gap? What kind of trends are you seeing kind of through your market research about where home buyers' expectations are? And is the industry living up to those expectations?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I think the top three things that we saw from the market research in terms of what a smart home means to consumers would that it helps them save energy, it improves the convenience of their life, and then it helps them save money. And what was interesting was that 90% of them had a concept of what a smart home was, but it's what I would term a woolly term. Like, you know, it isn't very crystal clear. It's not like a speed on a broadband where it's really it is or it isn't. I mean, a smart home can mean a variety of things. Is it your remote immersion, or is it that your fridge orders your groceries on your behalf? It's very much how it fits to your own family requirements. But I thought it was interesting as well that energy is such a key component of it, because that is really probably where we're going to see it become relevant. And that's the key word. I mean, smart technology without relevance isn't going to sell well. The key thing to it is that it's got to. And I think this is from taking off my new developments hat and thinking about operations. This is a key area as a broadband wholesaler in the market that we need to continue to evolve and stay up to date with emerging trends. We, as a wholesaler, we have 20 different retailers on our network, and we're reliant upon them to a degree to productize the offering to the consumer. But what is within our gift is to scope the service aspect of it, because that's not selling the boxes and the elements that are going to be plugged in and in play.
But this is about that underpins the smart. You know, so like you said, kind of a smart home is a woolly term. I don't think it is at all. I think smart to me is just an acronym for a synonym for connected. So once you can connect to the internet, you have the ability to be smart. And then everything else are just the IoT devices that you put on top of it. But the connectivity is the smart element. Is that wrong? Is that...
It's your definition. I think that's
I'm open to correction, Cian. I'm open to correction. No, genuinely though, like, because I think it's interesting. You know, I want to learn. I want to be informed. Tell me, what is the definition of a smart home to Siro?
So I think what it can be in future is a better usage of the new Wi-Fi protocol, Wi-Fi 6. A heat mapped premise such that your Wi-Fi black spots are identified and corrected on a proactive basis. So not just somebody coming in and doing it once and walking away. These are idiosyncratic radio signals from your mobile devices to your TVs, to your modems, and they can change And what you really want is to ensure that you've got a proactive management solution that is feeding into the cloud, running diagnostics, and then repointing them as the black spots reappear. And then that, because of that foundation of strong, well-performing, well-utilized network availability, that you then bolt on your IoTs that connect to your cloud, connect to your grocery accounts, connect to your security devices, connect to your entertainment requirements, connect to your work clouds, to your Citrix environments, and so forth. But it starts with the foundation. It starts with, and I think that's the big gap. Right now, if we deliver, Siro will deliver a 2 gig service into a premise. How do we get the most out of that is the question. So before we allow the Harvey Normans of the world to determine what an IoT environment looks like, we as wholesalers and we in the industry still have that gap to say we're delivering a phenomenal product, but we can still do more to help people get the most out of it. And without that, then it's just going to be, there'll be a level of frustration, I feel. And I see it with my own family. You know, I have aunts and uncles that try and connect different devices, and I'm the person that gets the phone calls to say, why isn't this working? And it's often because they've put the modem behind 15 photo frames and the thing just can't see it. So it's often basic things like that. So.
I don't think we can correct for human error.
There's an element to that. I think there's certainly improvements on it. I think it is a woolly term right now. But getting the most out of what we've got available is something that we can do more. And again, speaking to developers, speaking to M&Es, where do we position the access points? How do we make sure that we're bringing it into positions that then lend themselves to better experiences in the properties? As part of our discussion, that's part of what we talk about, whether we're talking about semi-detached developments or high density apartments, and having that whole process that you're picking up on, Carol, early at a stage of planning is fundamental to setting ourselves up for success, so that you take an element of the human part of it out of it, because we can't expect everybody to be experts.
Yeah.
And that's fair.
I suppose looking at the marketplace we're in at the moment, so many of our housing problems, whether it's across the public or private sector, whether it's for sales or rentals, so many of our problems and challenges come back to a lack of supply. So new supply, as much as possible, as quickly as possible, has to play a huge part in tackling the housing crisis right now. However, we know that commencement notices are down, which means our output for 2023 is likely to be well down, not just down, but well down on 2022 figures. So look, how is your pipeline looking over the next 12 to 18 months?
We see that. I mean, we track those same plan commencement notices, and look, our endeavor is to get to the sites that are active. We've seen sites paused. We've certainly seen them get to a certain stage, and then the funding conversations have changed. And while we've been, you know, very advanced in the discussions, then everything has just gone quiet, and that's the feedback we've gotten. So we see that in the market. But look, our role is just to be ready and available when called upon. We're perfectly happy to have all those calls with the M&Es, and if they don't progress, that's fine. But I think it is a concerning time. I mean, I do feel for people. I've friends that are similar ages that have, you know, gone traveling, come back, good savings, ready to go, can't buy, right? This is a societal problem that's unique in that it doesn't affect any one particular decade of generation. It affects so many. But from a broadband perspective, look, I think I'm always very conscious to not oversell the importance of broadband to rural living, because it's about so much more than that. It's got to suit you and again, I'm a bit of a poster child for it, for having left Dublin and doing something different. But I mean, I can't recommend it highly enough. And I think that when you look at how strong the fiber infrastructure is outside Dublin, there's a compelling reason. But again, it comes back to employers and are they willing to let people? It's not as straightforward a conversation as saying, well, if you've got broadband, well, then why wouldn't you? But I think what we can continue to do is to roll out the network as quickly as we can, and so that for those people to whom their circumstances, it does fit, that we continue to be ready and available. And it's a great thing for Ireland Inc. that we have as many premises passed with 100% fiber, I think.
Yeah, actually, I think that's a really fair way to put it, Cian, that you know, not or having broadband isn't the key to rural living, but not having it is definitely an impediment to it. So I think that's a really fair way to do it. But you're right. I mean, look, at the end of the day, everything that we're focused on in our business, our clients, our industry, it's all about getting new supply to the market. And whether that's bringing back properties into use, it's all about just getting new supply. So just before we finish up, for developers and contractors who are in a position that they're on developments now, obviously we want to get things, make sure that they get to completion stage and hand it over as quickly as possible. You know, what are the key considerations to ensure that they have a smooth and efficient process so there's no delays when it comes to connectivity?
Yeah, so again, siro.ie/new developments, you've a path to contact us through that. You can search us on LinkedIn, we're across social medias as well. So you'll reach out to us, speak to us. We have a team ready to respond and to engage with you and to talk you through whatever gaps there are. We have field-based agents that will come and attend your site and walk it off with your foreman. And I think that it's as early a stage, but look, if you're listening to this and you're halfway through and some of the houses are occupied and you're at slabbing or at foundation stages that others, it's still not too late. Still reach out to us. We'll have that conversation. That's par for the course for us. But we are ready and available to support the developers. And look, we're in a rollout phase. So we this is where we want to be, right? And the best we can do is be available. And I think the key elements to remember are that we sit inside the ESB assets, so you don't need to dig up anything to put us in. We're a 100% fiber service. As a wholesaler, we offer your end customers a choice of 20 retailers, including Vodafone, Sky, now Virgin Media, DigiWeb, one of the best rated retailer on Trustpilot. So it's a compelling proposition. And I think the main thing is that they can access to us through siro.ie/new developments.
Super. That's great. Thank you so much, Cian. That was Cian O'Mahony, Siro's Head of Operations and New Developments. And that's it from us this week. You can get in touch with the show on social media at iProperty Radio or by emailing hello@iPropertyRadio.com. My thanks to the Hear Me Roar production team and to Luke Delaney on sound for Dublin South FM. Until next time, thank you for listening.